Hi everybody, I'm Andrew Roberts from The Great Property Meet, and I'm here with Bill Stiles from Adept Electrical. And Bill is a qualified electrician who looks after some of my properties, but is also a business partner and a landlord himself. And I think that's important why I've chosen Bill, because he's a landlord. And we're here today to share with you the new electrical regulations, why they're in place and what you need to know about it, because I've had a number of people from my community at the Great Property Meet come to me and say, my electrician said I've got to get a new fuse board and it's this much money and it's got to be metal and blah 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 blah, and there's a lot of myths out there, so we're going to debunk those myths right now. So it all started back with the Electrical Safety Standards 2020 Act, which was originally designed to come into force 1st of April, but then was deferred to the 1st of July and is now in force. And it's a bit like a gas safety certificate, but it's once every 5 years. And so Bill, talk to me, what is this Electrical Standards 2020? How do I know what I'm gonna be doing? You know, how do I choose somebody?
Right. Well, The most important thing about this thing is to get someone who is competent and qualified to do the job. Okay, it's easy to fall into the trap of it's all cost related, but sometimes if you go for the cheapest contractor, whatever he gives you will be a waste of money anyway, because the condition report potentially might not stand up in a court of law to scrutiny.
Okay.
So the main thing is to employ a competent and qualified electrician to do the job.
So talk to me about qualified. I mean, I've heard of NEIC, you're a member of NAPIT. What do you mean they've just got to be a member of a trade body to be qualified?
It is helpful that they're a member of a trade body, because obviously that will, if you look up and ask them what trade body they're in, then you can go to that trade body and find out the extent of their qualifications.
Okay.
I would recommend that anyone who was doing a test and inspecting test and inspect on your property is qualified with a test and inspecting exam. You will be able to find that out from the trade body also as well, but you need to know that they have indemnity insurance as well, so they are qualified to do the work, and their advice is insured.
Okay. So we're talking about qualified persons here. I mean, before we go too far, I mean, do we have to test our own homes as well? Or is it just rental properties that this applies to?
The legislation applies to rental properties. You potentially, if you were to sell your house and on the searches it said, have you had any electrical work done? You would have to show that it's been done by a competent person, and that's where Part P comes in.
Okay.
But there is no obligation for someone in their own property to say, you've got to have it done. The legislation covers rental properties only.
So what's the purpose of this? I mean, it sounds to me a little bit like an MOT for a car, which is a bit of a license to print money for garages. Is this the same thing for electricians? Is that the purpose, to boost the electrician's wealth?
Definitely not. There's no... I don't know where they get all these perceptions of wealthy electricians, but the purpose of the report is, the purpose of the legislation is to ensure, basically to legislate the rental market a bit more. We can see this with planning, we can see this with tax, and this is just another thing where legislation is coming into the rental market. I mean, in my view, the purpose of it is to ensure the installation is safe, and that when you go to bed at night, you can sleep.
And that's an important thing as a landlord. You don't want to be the owner of the next Grenfell Tower. I mean, there have been a lot of cases where landlords have had properties and tenants have died because they've been electrocuted because of unsafe installations.
That is why this legislation has come in.
Mm-hmm.
People have died because of unsafe installations. That is really the purpose of it. It's to make sure that the installation is safe.
Okay. So something which I keep hearing from different members of my community is, I've been told I've got to change my fuse board. It's a plastic fuse board, and the electrician's telling me I've got to have a metal one, and it's going to cost this much money. Now, you've just done an inspection on my property. I've got a plastic fuse board, and you haven't said it needs to change. So explain to me what's happening here, and what advice would you give people on that?
Right, well, first of all, to understand, when you have the electrical condition report, you have codes. So you'll have a C1, which is immediately dangerous. So if an electrician finds a C1, there's a risk of immediate electric shock. So that could be something that's hanging forward, someone could touch it and get a shock. The electrician is actually under legal obligation to sort that out. So he can't necessarily leave a C1 and walk out your door.
So it's a bit like a gas engineer comes in and says, this installation's safe, and he basically bars it from use.
Correct. Then you have what's called a C2. C2 means it's potentially dangerous. That could be, for example, an electric shower without an RCD protection. So something has to go wrong, and then someone could be in the shower and get an electric shock. That could be the case. So potentially dangerous. That, if you have a C2 on a condition report, that is a fail. That's unsatisfactory.
Okay.
Now,
so does that mean you have to swap the fuse board out at that point?
You might have to swap the fuse board if there was no RCT protection on the fuse board at all.
Okay.
But for a plastic fuse board with RCT protection on, okay, you do not have to change it. A plastic fuse board is a C3, needs improvement, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to do it. It's because regulations, we're on 18th edition regulations.
Yeah.
Your installation was fitted to 16, so there's a bit of time between that. The installation, you do not enforce the regulations retrospectively. But if you do any new works, so if you were to do any work in your property that involved doing work that needed an RCD protection, then you will need to update your fuse board.
Okay.
Or to carry the works out to the current regulations in their form that they are now.
Yeah. So if I draw a parallel to a driving test here, you've got a major and a minor fail in your driving test, and then you've got get out the car, you're about to kill me.
Yeah.
Type approach.
Yeah.
And what we're saying is, if you've got a plastic fuse board, it's a C3 as defined in the regulations.
Well, it's what I work to is I'm a part of NAPIT, and they've got a code master's book. So you've got a bit of a book and you work to the codes, and every code is listed in there, and that's the code I work to.
Okay.
The market is what it is. People always have a view on the regulations and their views. And unfortunately, that is just the way it is. But that is the book that I work to.
Okay, so you're part of a trade body. I mean, one of the key things when choosing an electrician is there more than one trade body? And I'm guessing there could be different interpretations by different trade bodies then.
Generally speaking, no, because
okay.
The regulations are what they are. It's BS 7671. We all work to the same regulations. You will get some field officers that go out and assess electricians that possibly will have a view on certain things, you know. But really, with an electrical condition report, the main thing is to get someone that is qualified. If they are qualified and experienced, you're less likely to get this sort of variance of opinion.
So what trade bodies are there out there so that people know what to look for?
Off the top, we can go NAPIT, ELECSA, NIC and STROMA. Those are the ones I know off the top of my head, but I'm sure if we can list the other ones at the bottom, people can. And if you then approach that trade body and find out the person's membership number, then you can then check out their qualifications and their extent of their insurance.
Well, I was going to say, one of the things you said to me earlier was your aim is to leave a site safer than when you came. And you picked up as part of the testing that there was a loose live connection coming in from the outside into the fuse board. The screw was loose, which could arc and could cause a fire. So you've effectively made this building safer, and the property a safer place to rent as a result of that.
Yeah, yeah. So it's all part of the process. So when someone does the inspection, they will go around, check all the sockets, they would check the lights, they would check the connections, check the earth, they do a load of insulation resistance tests to check the integrity of the cables. And you know, by the time they finish, they will know that it's satisfactory or not satisfactory.
Well, it's taken you a couple of hours to do this, so that's not a quick sort of come in, got one of them little plug testers, plug it in, yeah, that's fine, and out.
Definitely not.
Quite an in-depth test. I'm sat here watching Bill with his tester and thought, what I need to do is share with you some of the key things that you need to consider, because as landlords, we might not want to do this, but once you've had it done, it lasts 5 years. So your property then has a report for the next 5 years, and you have to do it now every time a tenant moves into a property. So if you're renting a HMO out, that could be a new tenant moving into the room. So it's a bit of a run for electricians, so I imagine they're going to be in scarce supply, especially given the lockdown and the backlog of work that people have built up during a lockdown period.
Well, the thing is as well, it's getting the electricians in there in a safe environment as well. So when everyone's doing the work, I mean, we are trying to do it when in between the tenancies. Yeah. So when we're going in into the empty houses and doing it that way. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you give your electrician plenty of time and try and do it in between the people moving in and out, it's better for everybody.
Yeah. Well, you've done a brilliant job today, Bill. And if you need an electrical report, I'll put Bill's contact details down below. And it's Bill Stars from Adept Electrical. He's also a landlord, so he understands both sides of the fence. And that's why I thought Bill would give a really impartial view on the regulations and bust some of the myths out there that you need a new fuse board and it's got to be metal. We've just proven it doesn't, because it's only a C3, provided that you're obviously passing all of the other tests that have been taken out.
Yeah, okay, so I hope that's been useful anyway, Andrew.
Thank you very much, Bill.
Thank
all
you.
The best.
Thank you.